The Holy Gospel according to John, the 15th and 16th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus said, "When the Advocate comes, whom I will send to you from the Father, the Spirit of truth who comes from the Father, he will testify on my behalf. You also are to testify because you have been with me from the beginning. I did not say these things to you from the beginning because I was with you. But now I am going to him who sent me. Yet none of you asks me, 'Where are you going?' But because I have said these things to you, sorrow has filled your hearts. Nevertheless, I tell you the truth. It is to your advantage that I go away. For if I do not go away, the Advocate will not come to you. But if I go, I will send him to you. And when he comes, he will prove the world wrong about sin and righteousness and judgment. About sin, because they do not believe in me. About righteousness, because I am going to go to the Father and you will see me no longer. About judgment, because the ruler of this world has been condemned. I still have many things to say to you, but you cannot bear them now. When the Spirit of truth comes, he will guide you into all the truth. For he will not speak on his own, but will speak whatever he hears, and he will declare to you the things that are to come. He will glorify me, because he will take what is mine and declare it to you. All that the Father has is mine. For this reason I said that he will take what is mine and declare it to you." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
All right, you probably know what question I'm going to ask to start. But it is confession time, all right? How many of you watched the royal wedding yesterday? A fair amount. I thought there might be more. I thought there would be more Royals fans out there. Different Royals? Different. So I confess that I did not watch any of it, except for the most important part of any and every wedding, the sermon. Okay? Trust me, I know when people attend weddings, they are there to hear the sermon. That's what they taught me in seminary, at least. You know, that's what I'm there for, so I just assume everyone else is there for that same thing. But thanks to the power of the internet, I did not have to wake up in the middle of the night, but I was able to catch the recording of the Most Reverend Michael Curry, who is the presiding bishop of the Episcopal Church in the United States, also the first African-American man to serve in that capacity, as he delivered this incredibly powerful sermon, much to the chagrin of many British people who were in attendance there. So it was obviously a wedding sermon, which means that, of course, was all about love. So the question is, why am I bringing it up today on Pentecost and when we celebrate a baptism? Because near the end of his sermon, Bishop Curry referenced a French mystic, Pierre de Chardin, who suggested that the discovering and harnessing of fire was one of the greatest advances in all of human history. Fire is what has allowed human beings as a civilization to make any sort of advancements in this world. So the connection of that to his sermon was how Deschardins then went on to say that if humans could ever harness the energy of love, then for the second time in the history of the world, human beings will have, in his words, discovered fire again. So here we are today to recognize not a wedding, but Pentecost. 50 days after Jesus rose from the dead, the Holy Spirit, who Jesus promised his followers would come in his place, appeared among those gathered disciples like wind, like fire, like people speaking a cacophony of languages. It was like the breath of God that can blow through a valley filled with dry bones, a breath that can bring those dry bones back to life. It was a spirit among them, as Jesus said in John's gospel, like an advocate or a comforter or a helper. There are just so many ways to describe the power and the presence of God that was sent to accompany us when Jesus left. It's a spirit that's always been present in this world, but a spirit that takes on this new role after Jesus leaves the world and ascends to heaven. It's a spirit that sends us into this world to continue the work that Jesus commissioned us to do. What is it then that we are called to do? Who is it that we are called to be in light of all of this? Well, if we do believe this is the birthday of the church and the start of that Christian church happened on Pentecost with a rush of a violent wind and tongues of fire resting upon the apostles, and if we believe that it is that same spirit that is the presence of God in us and in this world, then why would we believe that we can just sit back and think that this life is going to be without struggle? Like Bishop Curry referenced in his Royal Wedding Sermon, fire changed the world once. Fire allowed humankind to survive and even thrive. We've seen fire as a sign of God's presence in the burning bush, in the Holy Spirit, in that first church at Pentecost. The second discovery, then, of this world-changing fire comes, as Deschardins said, when humans can harness the energy of love. Imagine what this force could do if all of us carried that very love into the world. I think one of our challenges is that we often, as a default, fall into the mindset of this Holy Spirit only being a comforter. That's one of the ways it's translated. Jesus calls it a paraclete. And as I said, it's translated as comforter. When the comforter comes, whom I will send to you from the Father. We default to that thinking sometimes. Oh, God's here. We'll be okay. But there's more to it than that. That word is really describing someone who's a helper or an advocate role, or really most literally in a legal defense role. So wait, Jesus promises to send us a defense attorney? Why would we ever need such a thing in this life of discipleship? Why would Jesus ever need the testimony from someone in that role? Well, I think we need that kind of help because the things we are called to do require us to step out on a limb in this world and take those risks. All those apostles who remained after Jesus ascended, they could have stayed in that locked room, basking in the victory that Jesus won over death, peacefully waiting for him to return. But no, when that spirit appeared among them, that spirit sent them into the world to testify to the truth of God. And how did that go for them? Well, a lot of them were mocked, tortured, imprisoned, even executed. Think about the way the Spirit came at Jesus' baptism. When John baptized Jesus in that river, as Jesus was coming out of the water, Mark says he saw the heavens torn apart and the Spirit descending on him like a dove. Such a peaceful and lovely scene, right? Two verses later, the Spirit immediately drove Jesus into the wilderness, where he was for 40 days being tempted by Satan. The Spirit that brought God's presence in those waters of our baptism is the very same Spirit that sent Jesus to look the devil square in the face. If baptism was only about God being with us, we would just bring Preston up front here by himself, splash some water on him, be done in 10 seconds. Right? But that's not what we did. We surrounded him with family and sponsors and the whole body of Christ. We took the time to confess who God is and what God has done for us. And then we made promises. Promises to support Preston in those times when he will find himself in the wilderness, face to face with evil. And promises to help him learn those things of our faith that will help him make a difference in this world. That same Spirit that showed up for him to offer that promise of God's grace in those waters is the same Spirit who will send him out to testify to the truth of God. That's the same Spirit who won't let us just sit back and let yet another school shooting happen and another 10 people get killed in a school, or let another police officer in our area get shot in the line of duty. It's a Spirit that instead sends us out to speak up for change and allows us to show this world God's love and that God's kingdom, what that is and why we need it here. We continually cry out, "Come, Holy Spirit, show us this presence," all the while knowing full well that the Spirit is alive and active, comforting us, comforting one another, and stirring us up to harness the power of that love in this world. Can we bottle that energy and take it to this world? Can we feel the Spirit this day and every day? Amen.